Okay, good.
Sure, that ship, is it open? Oh, thanks. Good evening, everybody. Good evening, everybody. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thanks for coming tonight to this lecture series on American demagogues and how to beat an American demagogue. Really honored to have you here for this conversation, for this body of learning. So I want to kind of just set a little context for this. So I'm David Domke. I'm a professor at the University of Washington and also a director of an organization in town called Common Purpose. We do work around civic engagement, particularly voter registration and voter mobilization. This particular lecture series I did earlier this year in January downstairs in Kane 120. And I've done it a couple places around town since then, and I'm honored to do it here again. And I kind of want to start with this. Like I make sense of the world through the lecture series that I put together. I use them as chances to figure out things, especially things that I'm scared about, or confused about, angry about, things that I really, you know, I'm trying to get a handle on. And I've been doing a lot of lectures lately, okay? Okay? Because there's a lot of things that scare me and confuse me and anger me. And I do them to learn first and foremost, and then I get interested and excited about what I'm learning, and I want to turn it into a series of talks. And what I've come to realize is that I need a few lectures to kind of like build the broader context and examine the pieces that are in play, rather than single lectures that are part of them. So you signed up for 5 lectures. And 5 has been kind of a good number for me. I'm also going to be doing some series next year that are 3 lectures. They give me a chance to kind of figure things out and understand them. If you're not here for every one of these lectures, you'll get the videos. And I want to just be clear that the videos will go to the email addresses I have. So if you signed up, if you're person A and you signed up, David Domke, but you also registered for 3 other tickets for another person, and you gave me just, and when you signed up, you used the same email address, the other 4 people are not going to get the video. You can pass it on to them, okay? But just, I'm just heading off the inevitable emails I will get, okay? Of like, I'm on your list and I didn't get the videos. And I'll look and I'm like, yeah, because I don't have your email address, right? So just check on that if you don't get the videos. It usually takes a couple days after each lecture to get it from UW Technology. If you just did a quick pivot, you'll see it says recording back there right now. So we're recording, and you'll get the chance to see the videos. And this makes it easy for people who, if it rains some night or something and you're not going to come. So I do these lectures because I want to learn and figure things out. I then do the lectures because I also want to share that knowledge and those things that I figured out or think I'm figuring out with other people. I've done a lot of these over time, and I've also feel a particular urgency about this series. This series really speaks to a crossroads that I think our country is at. I, of course, focus on topics and issues that matter because that's what draws me to them. But at this time, it really feels like we're at the verge of something and we don't know, we have no guarantees ahead of us. And so the reality is that we need to come with what I'll call kind of the full knowledge, the full armor of knowledge. Okay? So if you've been to this series already, you'll see much of the same material. But the world keeps turning between when the series has been done and the next time. And so there'll be different references, there'll be greater realities of feeling, the examples will be updated, and elements like that. I also know that every time I do the lecture series, I have to learn the material again. I don't have notes. This is all just stuff that like I read about and kind of remind myself about when I do the series. So I spent a couple hours today re-catching myself up and re-researching some pieces. So all of that just to say, really glad that you're here for a terrible topic. Okay? But your commitment for being here just shows that you want to understand and try to make a difference. So thank you so much. So tonight is the first of the five in the lecture series, and I want to start here. I'm going to flip down the lights a little bit. I want to start here with what I'll call a prologue. You know, I often read books, and sometimes a prologue is there at the beginning of the book, and the prologue is something that occurs before the main arc of the story you're going to read, but it has relevance. It says something that has relevance to the arc of the book, story that you're going to read. So it happens ahead of time, but it's not actually in the course of the events. So I want to start with an American author by the name of Sinclair Lewis. Sinclair Lewis is the first American to win the Nobel Prize for Literature. In 1930, he received the Nobel Prize for Literature. He's from Minnesota. His most famous book was Main Street, published in 1922, about kind of middle America. Then he wrote a book called Babbitt, which is kind of an ironic take, critical of capitalism and materialism in America. And then he wrote Elmer Gantry, which is a critique of this evangelical preacher who's hypocritical. All of those in the 1920s. In 1930, he's awarded the Nobel Prize for Literature, the first American author to receive this. Pretty big deal. In the 1930s, as events unfold in Europe, in Germany, in Italy, in Spain, he begins to be very concerned about the rise of authoritarianism and fascism. And so he writes a book in 1935 titled It Can't Happen Here. Okay? This is the title of the book. And here's the cover of the book. What will happen when America has a dictator? It Can't Happen Here, a novel by Sinclair Lewis. So it's a novel, which I think by definition means that it's supposed to be fiction. I'm not sure if that's actually true, but this is intended to be fiction. This is the promotional content for the book when it came out. This is what they wrote. A vain, outlandish, anti-immigrant, fear-mongering demagogue runs for president of the United States and wins. Sinclair Lewis's chilling 1935 bestseller is the story of Buzz Windrip, who promises poor, angry voters that he will make America proud and prosperous once more, but takes the country down a far darker path. As a new regime slides into authoritarianism, newspaper editor Doremus Jessup can't believe it. Can't believe it will last. But is he right? This cautionary tale of liberal complacency in the face of populist tyranny shows it really can happen here. Okay? So, this is a book, comes out in 1935. It's a cautionary tale, as it says at the end, to liberals who might rest comfortably, particularly white liberals, who might rest comfortably in the idea that these terrible fascist things, authoritarianism, dictatorships, won't happen in the United States. And it's an argument for, of course, that isn't so. Actually, it could happen here. This is kind of the prologue to this entire series. I don't know if there's any alignment you feel between that character and another fictional character that we have right now. So here's the overview of the lecture series. Tonight is what I'm going to call a typology and templates. A typology is a big kind of academic-y term, which means like just kind of making sense of types of things you find in the world. So what are the types of things? I want to talk about types of political leadership tonight, and then types of demagogues. Templates are kind of like what are the kind of ways they do what they do. So I want to introduce some frameworks for the whole series tonight. Next week, I want to talk about the road to Trump. The first two lectures kind of are continuations of each other. They have a series of pieces that are related. By the end of the second lecture, September 17th, we'll be at Donald Trump. On the third lecture, I'll talk about the first of three really crucial characteristics that I think matter for how we move forward and beat a demagogue. I call this mindset. The second one, October 1st, will be message, and then we will skip October 8th because it's Yom Kippur, and we'll come back on October 15th for mobilization. Three M's that we'll talk about as the pathways that we have to really invest in to go forward. These are the five lectures in this series. I want to start tonight with asking us, all of us, to participate for a moment, where we have two words, and you, each of us, has these two words, and I want to ask you for maybe a minute to contemplate this. And I would ask you, like, what are two words that capture your feelings about how we're going about the necessity or the importance of, or the way in which, or that we're going to beat a demagogue? So the question is, what are two words that capture the importance of this historical moment for you? And I'll take 1 minute for you just to think real quietly by yourself, please, and then I'm going to ask you to talk to somebody next to you. This is just like a little class, all right? So let's just go 1 minute here of just kind of like quiet reflection. What are two words that you personally have that capture you, your sentiments? Now, of course, there's no answer here. It's just whatever you're thinking. So take 2 minutes, talk to the person next to you, share your two words, and tell them a little bit about why those words. Why those words? Okay? Let's do that. So I don't know what words you came up with, and those are personal in terms of what those words might be. I just want to challenge you to think about what are some words that if you woke up every morning and you had them on your wall or on your screensaver on your computer, or it was the image on your phone, or it was the headline in the newspaper, or you put it on your refrigerator, that the kind of repetition of the words and the kind of reminder to oneself that we have choices every day of how we're going to feel and engage. That despite the despair and the difficulty around us, which is profound, that even the people who are targeted the most by this American demagogue president, still we have choices. We have some agency in this process. So as you think about the words that might define where you're at, I'll just share my two. Determined and engaged. Okay? And I would say that these are words that I have known and have owned, articulated, thought about for some time. But they are words that I wear differently at this point in my life, words that I wear differently at this point in American world history, at this point in my being a dad, all of these things. Like, determine and engage with a full sense of, like, it's December 7th, 1941. And I wasn't there, and I know it's highly likely I wouldn't have had the courage to do what many people did at that time, to enlist, to immediately go off and defend this country. But I have to do everything I can do now. I have to. And that's how I live out and honor those folks who did everything they could then, or in the civil rights movement, or in the 1800s, or farther back. So determined and engaged are mine. They are words that I think about a lot. They're words that I remind myself of. So just a little opening bit for us to set a stage for the lectures. Tonight then, this is the thrust of the lectures for tonight. Modern American Demagogues, a Typology and Templates. So I want to start, because I am at heart a professor, with some definitions. I want to start with some terminologies so that we know what we're talking about, or at least what I'm referring to when I use certain words. The left word on the left, demagogues, gets thrown around a lot. And so I want to kind of give some clarity what I mean by this. What do I mean by a demagogue? And contrast and use as a contrast another term that's occasionally used in the political arena but will be familiar to you when I define it, an ideologue or ideologue. Okay, so I want to contrast these two things, demagogues and ideologues. Both of these refer to people that in the political arena we would experience as divisive. These are folks who we would say, you know, they are challenging human beings. They are difficult human beings. They're tough to kind of like, they're not best friends. They're not touchy-feely pals. Okay? So I want to talk about then of the ways in which, in very profound ways, they're different. Okay? An ideologue is somebody who's profoundly and dogmatically committed to certain political ideas. That's where the ideologue comes from. It's the ideas, the notion of ideology, a set of ideas that have coherence and go together in some kind of way. So an ideologue is profoundly, and this is where they're not very friendly, dogmatically committed to certain political ideas, okay? Specific political ideas. A demagogue is profoundly committed to specific human hierarchies, with political ideas as merely the tools to get there. So this ideologue over here person is all about the ideas, dogmatically about certain ideas. Whatever those ideas and whatever the outcomes are, those are the outcomes. This person over here has certain outcomes in mind, the demagogue, that are hierarchical. Certain people are on top, certain people are on the bottom or below the top, and that the ideas are merely tools to get there. Whatever the ideas are, doesn't really matter. It could be one thing one day and another thing another day. Doesn't matter, because the goal is to get the hierarchical outcome that they want. So that's one thing that I'm referring to when I talk about a demagogue. Somebody who specifically sees the world in tops and bottoms, and is committed to affirming and strengthening those hierarchies. Ideas are merely tools to get there. Next, an ideologue seeks power to enact political ideas and policies and turn them into policies and laws. They want power because they believe in these ideas so much that they want power in order to enact those ideas. They wake up in the morning and they want to pursue certain ideas, and they know that political power is the mechanism to pursue those ideas. A demagogue wakes up in the morning and they want power to enact those human hierarchies. Like, hey, the more power I have as a demagogue, the more I can construct the world with the hierarchies that I think are right. Those could be racial, those could be gendered, those could be all kinds of different hierarchies. But I want to put those into place. So I want power, and when I get power, it's going to be the first thing I'm going to do. I'm going to issue a Muslim ban. Because the sole reason of coming into power is to enact that human hierarchy. Over here, the person's got ideas. Those ideas might lead to hierarchies. That's fine. Not fine in a real sense, but that's not the core goal of the individual. The core goal is, I got these ideas. I want to pursue these ideas. Lastly, an ideologue sees policies and laws as greater than, more important than, public communications, because they only really care about turning those ideas into policies and laws. The public communications are not really that important to the person. They really don't even want to talk to people half the time, unless they want to constantly talk about one thing, the ideas. All right? This person over here actually says policies and laws, they're one way I can get what I want. But another way I can get what I want is through creating a rhetorical space in which people just take it for granted that these hierarchies are the way to go. So the policies and laws can get you there as in a demagogue, but so too can your words and your images, they can get you there too. If you can say, send them home, that is as much of a win to the demagogue as the policies and laws that might be a Muslim ban. It becomes co-equally valuable to the demagogue, the public communications do. An ideologue, not so. A demagogue, yes, so. So let me just give you a couple examples. But before I give these examples, let me just kind of summarize it this way. You go to a party in the evening after this is all over, and you're happy, which will not be the case. But you're happy after you go, and you go out and you say, let's have a few drinks. And you go out with 5 to 10 friends. And one of those friends brings somebody you don't know. And that person, if they're an ideologue, that person is going to talk to you all night long about one thing. They're going to talk to you about one thing, Medicare for all. They're going to talk to you for about one thing, in economic inequality. They're going to talk to you about the fact that the Mariners are horrible. They're going to talk to you about one thing. And you are going to get so annoyed with that person, but you're not going to be like threatened by that person. This person's going to come in, and right off the bat, this person's going to be saying things that are racist, sexist, misogynist, horrible, whatever their particular pet things are, they're going to say them. And they're going to say them loudly, and they're going to say them in such a way that people in the room are going to be, some chunk of people are going to be in nice, polite, progressive circles, troubled by what's going on, all right? But that person is as determined as this person. They're not going to leave because they believe every bit as much in those hierarchies as that person believes in the ideas. And they're going to keep saying them all night long. And it is the reality of the psychology of communication that they are either going to win or they're going to fight to their death believing that the communication is as important. That's why they're going to keep saying it. And thousands of research studies have shown us that the mind is not simply, it just doesn't work this way where you're able to say, sorry, didn't hear that, didn't hear that, didn't hear that, didn't hear, no, you heard it. You heard it, you heard it, you heard it, you heard it. Over and over again. In all of the many hundreds of students, thousands of students I've had a chance to teach, so many times young females will talk about the devastating images that are present in our media system about thinness, about sexuality, and they know, and many men too, know that these are terrible, unrealistic, damaging for our society, and yet they are exposed to them every single day. And they cannot stop those here. So it is a constant fight against that. The demagogue says, I'm going to win. Even if I don't get those laws I want, I'm going to change the conversation. I'm going to change how people get treated. I'm going to change how other people act. Okay? That person's threatening and dangerous and does credible bad. This person's really annoying and a pain in the ass. Unless you agree with them, in which case you're like, that person deserves a statue. Okay? So let me just give you a couple examples. Ronald Reagan was an ideologue. All right? He believed in small government. Government was the problem, is his famous phrase in his inauguration, and sought tax cuts, run up our debts, did all kinds of things. But he had a certain worldview, a political worldview that was committed to a certain set of ideas. Ronald Reagan is an ideologue, or was. Ted Cruz is an ideologue. He really believes in many of the same things as Reagan: small government, anti-Obamacare, so much so that he shut down the government in 2013. He's a pain in the ass. Lindsey Graham, before something happened to him, Lindsey Graham famously said in the 2016 presidential campaign when he was running for presidency that if the full Senate was in session and somebody killed Ted Cruz on the floor, you would not have an eyewitness who would report what happened, okay? So Ted Cruz is an ideologue because he believes so firmly that he shuts down the government. Pain in the ass, can't stand him personally, but you know, at some level, you got to respect that he believes that much in what he's doing. Now, those are Republicans, right? Only Republicans are ideologues, or right? I mean, right? We agree on this. Democrats hate America, but they aren't ideologues, right? Just little jokes. So, wait, okay. FDR and LBJ were actually both ideologues. The New Deal is an ideology. That's what it is. It's a set of ideas about how government works. And Lyndon Johnson, before the disasters of Vietnam, had a whole set of ideas called the Great Society. That's an ideologue. Lyndon Johnson, you know, famously would be talking to people just like this. That's an ideologue. He was like, I'm just trying to go to the bathroom, President Johnson. And Johnson's like, let me tell you about the Great Society. And you're like, shit, I just want to go to the bathroom, all right? So we have Reagan historically, Cruz contemporarily, FDR and LBJ both historically. So there's a particular candidate running in the presidency right now on the Democratic side who's the clear definition of an ideologue. They're an archetype of an ideologue, okay? It's Bernie Sanders, right? Yeah. Bernie's the kind of person that, like, he would, like, stand up here and talk about economic inequality forever and ever and ever, yelling the whole time, right? The whole time. And we would be like, you could love the guy, but still you'd be like, Bernie, we've been here for 5 hours. I mean, but here's the beauty of Bernie Sanders. Like, he's been saying the same damn thing for, like, 35, 40 years, right? That's what an ideologue does. They don't quit. They believe in their ideas. I'm far more of a pragmatist. I'm like, well, we tried that for like a year. Didn't really work. So let's try something different. Bernie's like, no, hell no, I'm going to keep fighting this. And has he had influence? Clearly, yes. As sure as Ted Cruz has had influence. The Republican Party looks a lot more like Ted Cruz today than it looked like when Lindsey Graham was running against him. Graham looks a lot more like Cruz today than Cruz looked like Graham then. Okay? So these are ideologues. I'm not going to spend any more time talking about them because the focus of the lecture series is on demagogues, but just want to be really clear that the key difference here is that these people are about ideas and they are pain in the asses and annoying unless you totally agree with them. And these folks are about human hierarchies, and that's what they're about. That is what they are about. First, last, and always, they see the world in these human hierarchies. They exist. They want power to enact those hierarchies. Okay? All right, one more kind of set of framework pieces. So there are these people, ideologues and demagogues. So what is a demagogue? I want to talk about demagogues. So what do demagogues do? What makes a person a demagogue? How would I know a demagogue if I see one politically? Well, I want to talk about a couple of key traits that make someone a demagogue. First of all, they're going to engage in vilification. They're going to pick certain people and they're going to target them as a problem. They're going to carefully pick those people. These people don't get just picked randomly. They get picked because of the hierarchies they have. These people have. But if one group doesn't work, they just find another one, as long as it fits with the general hierarchies that they have. So the first thing that makes a demagogue is that they're going to vilify. They're going to target people and position them as the problem. Okay? Second, they are going to fear-monger. They are going to tell us that the world is a disaster, it's a very scary place, we're on the edge of a cliff, we're in national and potentially international peril, and that this moment requires special leadership. That we're in such a bad place that it requires certain kind of special leadership. And you're going to be surprised, but they're going to be the ones who say, like, I'm the one. Okay? So second, they say, we're not just in trouble. We're not just struggling. We're not just having difficult years or troubling economy or any of that. But no, we're in devastatingly difficult straits, and you should be afraid. They don't traffic in healing. They traffic in fear. Okay? Third, they are revelatory, by which they claim they have special knowledge that no one else has. They know things that no one else knows, according to them. And everybody else are idiots. So today the president fires John Bolton, right? This is, what, his third national security advisor that he's fired in 2.5 years, right? Because he's smarter than all of the other ones. Now, Bolton, man, I don't want him to be our national security advisor, all right? I'm glad he's not national security advisor, but the reason the president is firing all of these people constantly is because they're all idiots and he's smart in his worldview. So the revelation he has, the demagogue says, I know things that no one else could ever know because I'm the chosen one. Now, he would never say that, right? So, they vilify specially targeted, often vulnerable groups. They fearmonger, they want us to be constantly afraid. Third, they regularly position themselves as the keeper of special knowledge. Fourth, they claim to be a populist. They claim, no matter who they are really, they claim that they're the person who's running on behalf of the kind of forgotten or ignored person. Usually, this is a gendered terminology. Usually, it's like, I'm running on behalf of the forgotten man. And the gender elements really do matter in all of this, because it is particularly white men who resonate with this kind of these kind of demagoguery ideologies. So they claim, no matter what, you can be born into wealth, you can have had the system work for you, been the star of reality TV, been the pals of all these wealthy, rich people, and still you can position yourself as the person who is the populace, the one who's standing up for the forgotten factory workers of the Midwest. Right? It's an unbelievable rhetorical maneuver that is audaciously ludicrous, but that's what a demagogue is all about. They're like, you don't think this is going to work, and it's going to work. Watch. And then last, they're a performer. For them, it's a demagogue show, 24/7. Like, this is the drug. The worst thing for a demagogue is to ignore them. To like say, you're irrelevant. So they constantly say things and do things in order to keep the attention. So they got to be performers. They got to love the spotlight. They have to crave it. They've got to have it. They have to insert themselves into the middle of every dynamic because they have to be at the center of it all. So these five characteristics are things that I'm going to talk about when I go through a series of people who have functioned as political demagogues in the United States. They are individuals who vilify certain targeted and vulnerable groups. They are folks who traffic in fear and believe and invest and make sure that we're always scared. They are revelatory in their presentation of self. They claim they have special knowledge that no one else has. They position themselves as populists, as people who know things. People who stand on behalf of others. All of the kind of like forgotten, left behind, working class people in this country. And then lastly, they thrive on the show. It is the show. They are the show all the time. Okay? So I'm going to kind of simplify all of this in what I will call kind of like a narrative, a demagogue narrative. All right. It's the narrative that every demagogue utilizes, and they certainly have nuances to it, but these are the pieces, and it's those five up there, but this is how it plays out in actual words, okay? Certain people, some people, certain people are endangering America. Certain people are endangering all of us. I can save us. I can do it. I'm not going to do it for me, though. I'm going to do it for everybody else. I'm here for you. It's not about me. I'm here for real America. And I'm going to tell you this all the time. The show is going to always be on. I'm going to call in to TV shows and radio shows. You give me a new technology, like, oh, I don't know, one I can type out things on my phone. That's like my dream. That's like giving a bad drug to somebody who's already got a drug addiction. Like, this is it. So this is the narrative of a demagogue. There are certain people in our society, I'm going to name them. They're very specific. They're Jewish. Or they're, that couldn't happen here. That's only in Germany. No, actually, they're not Jewish in America. They're Muslim. Okay? Or they're black, or they're immigrants, are endangering America. They're coming like caravans and floods. I can save us. I can do it. I'm the one. I am the chosen fucking one. I stand for real America. I'm doing this on behalf of all of you people who can't stand up and have been left behind. And I'm going to tell it to you over and over and over and over again. I'm never going to deviate from this message. Never. I can lose badly in a midterm election cycle with this message, and I'm still going to double down on it. Because I'm a demagogue who believes in the hierarchies that these messages construct. Okay, so demagogues, not ideologues, are interested in human hierarchies. They want power to enact those. This is how they talk about the world. They've got to have people that they're saying are dangerous. They got to convince us that those folks are endangering America, and so on. All right, last little bit of the framework is, what are the contexts in which this matters most? Because so far I've been talking about people, what people do. What the demagogue does is this. But the demagogue, or any person, doesn't exist in a vacuum. We exist in the middle of contexts and particular moments in the world, in histories. And I'm a student of history. I read history in order to understand and be inspired and to be challenged by where I am now. And it is way easier to read about tough contexts and historical moments than it is to live through them. All right? It's like when I read stuff about Reconstruction, which I do all the time, I say, wow, that's incredible. How did they do these things? Or I can't believe these horrible people did these horrible things. Or these incredible courageous people did these incredibly courageous things. And I don't actually have to read that now to have to kind of have those same, like, how does this, I don't know, it's actually happening right now. So what are we going to do? Right? So the context looks pretty similar. Usually there's some cultural, economic turmoil and fear, things that throw us off our game, that make us really unsure-footed. So we're scared, we're nervous, we're anxious. And it's not that we're crazy to be that. I mean, there's actual things going on. Usually there's some kind of massive technological change that's underway that is affecting our communication styles. And the demagogue capitalizes upon those communication changes and usually is an early adopter of them and uses them effectively. So usually there's some kind of massive technological change. And there, and this is really important, there are, in these contexts, the counter voices are not ready. They're insufficiently alert, they're insufficiently equipped, and they're insufficiently engaged. These are three different characteristics. They're not paying attention, They are not equipped, even if they are paying attention. And even if they are paying attention and are equipped, they aren't engaged enough to do something about it. Okay? These are contexts. That's the liberal complacency from that book blurb that I read. This notion that it can't happen here. So why should I be vigilant? Well, people who look like me, this is the problem. People of color, they don't exist in that fiction. Because they've had to be vigilant from day one. But people who look like me, we get into this liberal complacency of like, hey, you know what? Trump, he wouldn't be too bad. Maybe we won't need to vote, or maybe I'll vote third party candidate. Donald Trump won in Michigan, Wisconsin, Pennsylvania by fewer votes than Jill Stein got in each of those states. Okay? Those are choices people make. They're choices we make. All right? So counter voices are insufficiently alert, equipped, and engaged. And then kind of the crossover piece is that a charismatic performer gets mainstream political cred. This is where they get launched. They get kind of like, they get catapulted essentially into the political arena. Because here's the reality. Let's take three categories of American life. These are the underbellies of American life. Racism and racial demagoguery, religious hostility or religious demagoguery, and conspiracy theorists. And we can kind of think about like the white nationalist, the David Duke over here. We can think of the religious kind of demagoguery of certain conservative fundamentalist evangelicals. Or we can think of conspiracy theorists like Alex Jones. Right? All of them exist in American life. But they are bounded by these certain subcategories of life. Alex Jones is not like a massive political figure. He is bounded in this kind of conspiracy arena. Yeah, he had a radio show and so on, but he was always bounded in this kind of conspiracy space. And these kinds of folks who exist have what I'll call distinct publics. They do. They have millions of people who listen and follow and read along and watch and cheer. They do. And that's a problem. That's a huge, huge problem. It's a massive problem. But in a democracy, we're going to have that. Because you got free speech, and people can make and be horrible, can make bad decisions and be horrible people. And I'm prepared to live with that horribleness as long as it's bounded. Because people do have individual freedoms to some significant extent. So these kinds of folks exist in our society. They're put into like categories, they're bracketed. They aren't given mainstream political cred. Well, what happens if you enter the national political arena, if that charismatic performer gets launched into the national political arena through a reality TV show, through a stage, a debate stage, through getting an opportunity to articulate an argument that the President of the United States is not an American citizen, and given constant opportunities to articulate that, and you get seen all of us, you get seen over time as like, maybe you're you're okay. Then what happens is you begin to move into a mass public space. And so what national politics does is it moves the demagoguery into a mass public space. And that's when we've got a really big problem. Because if these individuals are supported by a particular political party, they get the institutional cred of that party. If they're supported by the voting populace of certain states, they're supported by that. If they're supported by corporations or organizations, then they get that cred. And so this is the problematic. I mean, the first group is terrible too, the racial, religious, conspiracy theorists. But they're bounded in ways that I accept and just navigate through in our American public life. But in the national political space, all bets are off. If a demagogue gets launched into the national political space, I would suggest to you today that they actually might have the upper hand. They might have the upper hand given our communication space. The ability to construct that kind of show across the bottom, to identify certain people that say that they're endangering America, to play upon this incredible fear that many people have, that I alone can save us, because we are looking for somebody to like, we want that person. So The reality is that person, if they get launched into this space, they get access to the mass public. And that's what happened with Donald Trump. And Donald Trump is not the first American political demagogue. In this series, and I'm going to talk about five demagogues that precede Donald Trump. And we could go back further in time than I'm going to go back, and we could identify some more. But he is the first to become the president of the United States. Okay? So he crossed some kind of magic membrane in our communication space, in our complacency point three, the counter voices being insufficiently prepared and alert and engaged. He was able to cross a membrane into a space that will forever define this country. You know, we will never not have this. You know, there are mistakes that we make in our lives that sometimes are left behind, and other times they define us forever. And we will always have this. So, demagogues, they do these terrible things, they vilify and so on. They prey upon certain contexts. They use those contexts to their advantage, communication contexts, social and political contexts, technological contexts, they use them to their advantage. And if they can get launched by, for example, to be very clear, by Fox News, if they can get launched into the mainstream political arena, then all bets are off. So I would love to tell you that we're never going to see a Donald Trump again. But actually, I think we're going to see more. We're probably going to see more. Because politics is nothing if it's not mimicry. It mimics. If there's success one way, then someone will try to adopt that approach subsequently. Okay? So let's think about national politics. Or I could just stop here because we're all happy. And I want to do what is my favorite thing to do on PowerPoint, is I want to put a long timeline on one slide, okay? So today it's 2019, and let's imagine we're going back in years, in time, and I want to talk about what I would consider modern American political demagogues. So these are, I'm going to limit this to the 20th century, because the reality of presidential candidates and political candidates, it just becomes a different phenomenon when certain media arrive on the scene, okay? And campaigns start to operate in certain ways in our country. So I'm gonna limit it to this period of time. And I wanna talk about five demagogues that lay the groundwork for Donald Trump. That Donald Trump, whether intentionally or just intuitively, has picked up their pieces and has used them for political advantage. And so where would I go back to? So I think about American history, and I think about American politics, and I go back in time, and there's a couple people right off the bat, I'm like, yeah, they're gonna be on this list, but where would I start? And as I read historians and scholars of politics and sociology, and looking at the media systems, where I decide to go back to is 1928, okay? Into the 1920s, a period of, between what we now know as the two world wars, but a period of great change and turmoil in our country. So here are some of the contextual elements, because I want to always start with context. What's the context thing that allows someone to come in and capitalize? Well, radio and film have arrived on the scene as defining media in our country. Radio is in the early 1920s has become a national phenomenon. Broadcast stations start, first one in Pittsburgh, they go all over the country, they begin to broadcast and people, it becomes a phenomenon, and FDR, of course, will famously use this for his fireside chats. But film, too, has broken through kind of a media structure, so that we're seeing these moving images and these powerful emotions, and we're feeling all these things. In the 1930s and from 1930 to 1940s kind of is called in the movie industry kind of the golden era of film. This kind of era in which film just captures the American psyche in certain ways. So we have this grand technological changes going on. We have great economic inequality. if you look back historically from now back through all 250-ish years of the American kind of experiment in democracy, the greatest kind of stratified economic inequality in this country is now. And before that, it was in the 1920s. So there was great economic inequality. The wealthy getting wealthier, the poor getting poorer, the working class being left behind. It eventually leads to this economic crash, the stock crash. But there's great economic inequality. Jim Crow laws, the racism, the segregation, the discrimination that defined America for decades and decades is present all over America. People being told you can't drink out of these drinking fountains, and if you do, you're physically at risk. Jim Crow everywhere, in politics, in economics, in food, in every portion of American life, particularly in the South, but not solely in the South. Religious bigotry, this is some of the most hostile anti-Catholic, anti-Semitic periods in our country, the KKK, which starts or restarts again in the late 1910s and early 1920s. Their primary focus at this time is not actually African Americans, it's Catholics and Jews. Okay? So religious bigotry is a big deal. And, you know, women have just gained the right to vote in 1920. And so this is a very contested space culturally. Should women vote? Should women run for office? What about the notion of female power? So all of this is pretty turmoil, pretty big turmoil. And again, if I was reading books about this, I'd be like, "That is, wow, that's really interesting. It's really interesting." So we have all of this going on. And I go to 1928 because this is when the first demagogue who I want to talk about arrives on the scene. Now, I'll just be clear that there is no, like, look up Wikipedia list of demagogues, okay? You can't, like, say, search political demagogues, yes, these five, right? There is subjectivity to this. There are choices to be made. I am right, just so we're clear, okay? But there are five that I'm going to talk about. You might come up with others, and people do argue with me through the course of these lectures. Like, how could you not include her or him or whatever, okay? But I'm going to start with this one, Huey Long. Okay? So Huey Long, largely forgotten, particularly to people who lived above the Mason-Dixon line. But Huey Long is really an important figure in American life. And I want to tell you a couple things about him. He had a message. His message was on economic uplift. He was in Louisiana. That's where he was living, in Louisiana. And he focused on economic uplift. And he created a slogan. It wasn't "Make America Great Again." It was "Every Man a King." And again, these are gendered dynamics. "Every Man a King." He made a song about this too, that goes something like, "Every man a king, everyone a billionaire." He's trying to create this imagery of, like, you're poor because people have made you poor. You can be rich. I'll make you prosperous. Come with me. Okay? Focus on economic uplift. He traveled Louisiana giving, in 1 year alone, 600 speeches, running for governor. He was running for governor in 1928. Travels across the state. He's on radio constantly. He has these flyers that they post everywhere, the "Every Man a King" kind of slogan. He creates a song. He can sing. He plays that on the guitar, the banjo or something. So he's a performer. He's Huey Long, a performer. And he despised the news media. He called them the lying newspapers. All right? The fake news, right? It's the same thing. The demagogue narrative that I've laid across the bottom isn't that different from person to person. Sometimes the people who are being targeted are the media, right? So the lying newspapers. He went on to create his own newspaper because he didn't trust those. Trump didn't need to because he's got Fox. But anytime Fox gets out of line, he makes it very clear that, like, this is not going to stand. He did that in the middle of the 2016 presidential primary. And you know who lost? Fox lost. They got back in line with Trump. They lost viewers. Huey Long is elected governor in 1928 of Louisiana. He's elected U.S. Senator in 1930. So he's an ambitious guy, right? I'm going to show you a video clip here. And so here's one thing about Long. Long's elected governor in 1928, runs for U.S. Senator in 1930. And it's commonly the place that if you hold an office and your election cycle is not up and you're not up for re-election, you can run for another office. You can do that and not have to give up yours unless you get elected. He long got elected and said, I'm not giving up the governorship. So Huey Long was governor and U.S. Senator for 2 years, okay? So let's just learn a little bit about Huey Long.
The Louisiana Constitution barred any man from succeeding himself as governor. This presented only a momentary awkwardness for Huey Long. He announced he would run for the United States Senate in 1930. The campaign would be a referendum on Long's program, and he made it clear he had no intention.
In bed, just, I don't trust it, man. You got this. I know, I got it.
Intention of resigning as governor, even if he won, until his term ended 2 years later in 1932. When he would hand over the office to a successor pledged to carry out his wishes. To defuse opposition from the press, he launched his own newspaper, the Louisiana Progress. Its cartoonists and editorial writers paid to vilify the opposition and glorify their hero.
Well, he called the mayor of New Orleans Turkey Head Walmsley, and that's a reference to a turkey buzzard. And he had a wonderful artist that would draw cartoons, and he would sit up on a fence, all of the enemies, and he'd put buzzard bodies on them and their heads, and he'd make their faces look like turkey buzzard beaks.
We call in Mr. Rockefeller.
Huey was a mudslinger, a genius at invective, and a master of abuse. He could make a nickname fast, and he could make it stick. Names like Whistlebritches Richter, Shinola Phelps, Feather Duster Ransdell, and Colonel Bow Wow Ewing, as well as a barnyard of trough feeders, buzzard brains, hogs, pigs, and shotes. He threatened this menagerie variously with burning, skinning, corkscrewing, flaying, shooting, beating, stomping, broiling, braining, frying, and worse. His enemies tried to give as good as they got, calling him the Messiah of the Rednecks and Huey the 14th. The Louisiana Progress was delivered by state police cars to every parish. All public employees were expected to subscribe. Meanwhile, 10% was subtracted from each state worker's monthly salary. Long kept the proceeds in a chest he called the deduct box. From this reserve of hard cash, Huey financed the political campaign, paid his travel expenses, and encouraged legislative support.
Despite the heat of the campaign, the primary is a peaceful one, the most peaceful in years, old-timers say. Even Mayor Walmsley himself is surprised at the lack of outbreaks. He has a bigger surprise waiting him because the kingfish is still the kingfish.
On election day, Long carried 53 of the 64 parishes in the state. The people had spoken, and the legislature, which had once tried to impeach him, now had to listen. Long did not plan to take up his senatorial duties for 14 months, plenty of time to cement his hold on Louisiana and to transform whole parts of it. When an important anti-Long legislator stubbornly refused to go along with his call for a new 34-story state capitol building, the tallest in the United States, Long drilled a hole in the ceiling of the old Capitol and had the man's seat moved so that water from the leaky roof streamed onto his head. The new building went up. It was a monument to Huey Long.
Trump Tower.
A new campus for Louisiana State University was built, Huey's special pride. Nothing consumed more of his attention. He diverted highway funds to pay for a massive building program, hired and fired its football coaches and its presidents. And he dealt swiftly with campus critics. He once suspended 22 journalism students, explaining, "This is my university, and I ain't paying anybody to criticize me." He sat on the bench during LSU games, thought up plays, gave locker room pep talks between halves, and even helped compose the school marching song. In 1932, 2 years after he was elected to the Senate, his hand-picked slate swept the statewide election. The new governor-elect was Oscar O.K. Allen, a boyhood friend, and so agreeable, according to Long's younger brother Earl, that when a leaf blew onto his desk one morning, Allen signed it. Huey Long was now a United States Senator, chairman of the State Democratic Committee, and in effect still governor of Louisiana. He ran LSU, the Highway Commission, the Levy Board, the Board of Education. He controlled the patronage and policy in hospitals, prisons, and schools. The state militia and National Guard were his private armies, and effective political opposition had almost ceased to exist. It was the largest concentration of political power in one man's hand the country had ever seen. 4 days later, he left for Washington.
So Huey Long, his nickname was the Kingfisher, or the Kingfish. So he's elected governor, elected senator, has his complete iron hand, iron fist approach to Louisiana politics. But it's not enough. He wants a national platform. And so he begins to push for that. He begins to travel the country, begins to pursue relationships, begins to become he goes on national radio programs. He takes this every man a king and creates a share our wealth, almost like a great society kind of idea, share our wealth national proposal, and launches this in 1935. I think it's important for me I'll say this again in a second for taking aside. He was actually fighting the wealthiest people in this country. That's what he was doing. Okay, he was literally fighting the wealthiest people in this country. So you might think today that the demagogue only is the one who upholds those wealthy people, but not what he was doing. He was fighting the wealthiest people in the country. Share our wealth, that sounds pretty socialistic to me. All right, national proposal. It was such a concern to Franklin Roosevelt that he responded with a second New Deal that basically took half of his ideas. Huey Long's ideas. Took Long's best ideas and responded with a second New Deal to cut off Long as a political force. So this is 1935. In April of 1935, Huey Long's on the cover of Time magazine. He's getting a national following. He is clearly moving from a very powerful position in Louisiana, which is by and large a kind of backwater part of American life at this time. He's moving into the national space, so much so that the President of the United States is responding to him. He goes to Philadelphia in 1935 and speaks to thousands. Every indication are that he's going to challenge Franklin Roosevelt for the Democratic nomination. He announces plans to do so, okay, in 1935. He goes back to Louisiana. He's in power there. He goes to the state capitol where he's using his force and his power to do everything that he wants to do. And he's shot there on September 8th, 1935. He is killed in the state capitol by a political opponent. It is what historians consider, or scholars consider, the only actual political assassination in a political space that we've ever had in American national politics. He's shot and killed in the Louisiana State Capitol. So he's killed. This is one way you stop a demagogue. You kill them. When he's killed, the Nation, which is still around as a left publication, writes not really an obituary. It's more of a reflection upon Huey Long, and they say the assassination of Senator Huey Long will immediately arouse sympathy for his memory that could not be felt for him while he lived. Political murder is a vile crime. And we share the regret and shame felt by the country that he was defeated by a bullet and not in an open political contest. We also give him the credit he earned for pushing through reforms in Louisiana, simplifying an antiquated state machinery, redistributing the burden of taxation, and stimulating the interest in education. Nor shall we question that his championship of the poor was as sincere as anything in his equipment of distorted passions. That's a fairly passive-aggressive compliment right there, okay? A second part from the Nation's essay. Giving him every advantage of sympathetic consideration does not, however, raise him to the status of martyr. Huey Long was America's first dictator. His was a little dictatorship in domain, but it was grim and vengeful in spirit, and it was a sensational challenge to democracy. His death undoubtedly means troubled times in Louisiana. Nationally, however, the political situation is simplified. Now there will be no formidable third-party movement in the South threatening to wreck the Democratic Party. With the death of Long, the field of demagoguery is left to Father Coughlin, of whom one need be much less afraid. Father Coughlin was a Roman Catholic priest who had a national radio following of millions of Americans, highly anti-Semitic, highly racist. But their point is, Coughlin, as horrible as he is, we need be much less afraid. He's not a national politician. So Long, in my argument here, is the first demagogue, the first kind of American, modern American political demagogue. He was moving into the national space. I don't know, could he have become president? I don't know. The history doesn't allow us to know this. He was killed. He was killed. Okay. Okay. I want to talk about one more demagogue tonight. And there are two in the five that, to me, are obvious. They must be in there. They're on the Mount Rushmore of demagogues, okay? So the second one I want to talk about is Joe McCarthy, right? Now, Joe McCarthy, he came from Louisiana too, right? Wisconsin? Joe McCarthy was from Wisconsin? Damn. Because you have this image, we have these images of these progressive, northern, highly educated spaces. But no, Joe McCarthy, he's a Wisconsin U.S. Senator. So let's learn a little bit about McCarthy. So what's the context? Because again, context always matters here. TV has arrived. It was started in the 1930s, put on hold. The technology was during World War II because all resources were devoted to that effort. Then eventually gets rebooted and restarted up again in the late 1940s. By the 1950s, television is arriving on the scene in America, and people in political office are starting to think about how to use it. And they will in 1952 with some of the first advertising. So TV is turmoiling technologically the society. We have the Cold War, the post-World War II era, when all of the realities of the Iron Curtain and the Cold War and the claims about godless communism as a threat to America and to the world are felt viscerally by Americans. It is not some kind of a crazy shit that they were thinking. No, this was very real, this fear, this reality that the USSR was taking over portions of the planet and implementing what many Americans concerned about religious faith, Christian religious faith especially, saw as godless communism. So these are visceral fears. So much so that we get into the Korean conflict and the war because there is this belief that the United States needs to stop the Soviets in Southeast Asia in Korea before, according to the theory, the domino of countries go all across the East, the Far East, and then to the West. So we get into a conflict which, when you've been through two world wars, you don't know if the next one's going to be as big and as bad and as horrible. So these are real fears. Civil rights are rising. Americans have come back from World War II. And have demanded that, look, we fought for this country. We demand our rights here now. And the Brown v. Board of Education set of court the court decisions that culminate in Brown v. Board of Education in 1954 are all working their way through the system thanks to the NAACP. And so civil rights are rising in significant ways. In 1948, Harry Truman issues a decision that the military should be integrated, racially integrated. So civil rights are rising. So McCarthy's elected a Wisconsin senator in 1946. He beats in the Republican primary, not in the general election, but in the Republican primary, Robert La Follette, whose father was considered the father of progressive politics, and La Follette was a very liberal Wisconsin senator. McCarthy challenges them, runs against them in the primary. And the Republican Party is very strong in Wisconsin at this time. Runs against him, beats him by a couple hundred votes. Okay. In his campaigning, he runs on a terminology he self gives himself, Machine Gunner Joe, arguing, presenting himself image-wise that he had been this war hero, that he had fought in World War II. And indeed, the history tells us that he did fly in a few planes. He did. But he saw no significant combat. Okay? So he created this mythology around who he was and used it to argue that La Follette was not a patriot because he had not enlisted in the military. La Follette was well into his 40s when World War II broke out. And so he, you know, the notion that he would enlist, he could have, but it wouldn't have been expected of him. But McCarthy creates this mythology for his own benefits, takes down this kind of progressive hero, becomes a senator, wins the primary, and then coasts to victory. The Republican Party dominates Wisconsin at this time. So he's a first-term senator, and he gets to late 1940s, and he goes home during the holiday break of 1949, and he sits down with his strategist, and they have this kind of heart-to-heart conversation. And they say, you know, are you going to run again? Because it's time to kind of start creating energy and momentum towards running again in a 1952 election. Are you going to run again? And he says, yeah, I want to run again. And they say, great, what's our issue going to be? What are we going to run on? What's going to be the platform? And they think about it, and they literally sit in a room and debate and discuss for days. What's going to be the issue? And McCarthy comes to the conclusion that anti-communism is the issue. That's the issue, given this context, that anti-communism is the issue. But to differentiate himself from other people who are also big anti-communists, his argument is going to be that the communists are not just over there. They're here. They're here. And that's why you should be afraid. And that's why you need me. So he goes to Wheeling, West Virginia, gives a speech on February 9th, 1950, a speech that becomes known as the Enemies Within speech, the Enemies from Within speech, in which he says this. He's talking about the kind of arc of the struggle in the Cold War. This indicates the swiftness of the tempo of communist victories and American defeats in the Cold War. As one of our outstanding historical figures once said, when a great democracy is destroyed, it will not be by enemies from without, but rather because of enemies from within. The reason why we find ourselves in a position of impotency, it's really an interesting word. Why we find ourselves in a position of impotency is not because our only powerful potential enemy has sent men to invade our shores, but rather because of the traitorous actions of those who have been treated so well by this nation. It has not been the less fortunate or members of minority groups who have been traitorous to this nation. This sounds a little bit different than you might think from a demagogue. But rather those who have had all the benefits that the wealthiest nation on earth has had to offer. The finest homes, the finest college education, and the finest jobs in government. This is glaringly true in the State Department. There, the bright young men who are born with silver spoons in their mouths are the ones who have been most traitorous or traitorous. Last, I have here, and he holds up a piece of paper, in my hand, a list of 205, a list of names that were made known to the Secretary of State as being members of the Communist Party and who nevertheless are still working and shaping policy in the State Department. So he gives this speech in Wheeling, West Virginia. It's February 9th, 1950. This is, at that time, it is a speech to the Republican Party in West Virginia in what is known as their kind of Lincoln celebration. He gives this speech. it gains a little bit of national attention. But he sees this incredible reaction from the people in the audience. And any effective demagogue is fed by the crowd reactions. It is this emotional drug. And so he decides, you know what? That works. And so he begins to launch a crusade around the country in which he goes speech to speech, holding up a piece of paper, claiming that he has got the information, that he has the revelation. He has the information that no one else has. His targets are communists and homosexuals in government. So, you know, again, everybody's got, the demagogues have their targets. His are communists, supposed communists in government, and homosexuals. At this time, there was a line of argument that if someone was gay in government, they were a vulnerable person in government because that could be used against them politically. So the argument was that these people are endangering America, people who are communists and or gay people in government. So I just want to give you a 20-second taste of Joe McCarthy, because that's all we really need. No. Hang on. Okay. This is a clip from when McCarthy is at the 1952 Republican nominations.
One communist on the faculty of one university is one.
We're going to hear this again.
One communist on the faculty of one university is one communist too many. One communist among the American advisors at Yalta was one communist too many. And even if there were only one communist in the State Department, even if there were only one communist in the State Department, that would still be one communist too many.
He speaks in these hypotheticals. If there's one, it's too many. So he started with, and that was not unusual for the things he would do, with faculty, professors like me. And at this university, there were several professors whose lives were destroyed. At this university. Because of a series of hearings that spun out of the McCarthyism that became the Canwell hearings in this state. Canwell was a state legislator and implemented a series of hearings here, destroyed the lives of several faculty here. So we're talking about real people, real lives, of course. Hundreds of people destroyed in Hollywood, State Department lives, and so on. But it's a political issue, and it enacts the human hierarchies that he wants, with him on top and anti-communists on the bottom, gay people on the bottom. The news media rode the tsunami. This is what they always do. There is money to be made. There is a great story to be told. We don't need to be, or you can be, completely pissed and cynical about it, or you can simply see it in purely capitalistic terms. They rode the tsunami that was Joe McCarthy. So So McCarthy catapults into national attention. And he decides that he needs a right-hand person who's going to be his hatchet man. The person who's going to do all the dirty work for him, which allows him as a U.S. Senator to kind of ride above it all, but to have the person who's going to drive the testimony and do the behind-the-scenes research. And so he says, I need a lawyer. I need somebody who is soulless and will do this work. So he looks around, and there was a lawyer in the Rosenberg case. A guy who had been a key lawyer who had brought testimony against Ethel and I don't remember the gentleman's name. Julius. Ethel and Julius Rosenberg had led to their executions as supposedly spies. The historical evidence probably suggests that they were actually, but this gentleman drove the process and got some people to testify in ways that history suggests to us were false, to make sure that these people got executed, the Rosenbergs got executed. So he says, I need that person. I need that guy. And so he hires a guy by, damn it. Let me come back to Margaret Chase Smith in a second. He hires Roy Cohn in 1951. Okay, Roy Cohn is that lawyer. And he becomes the hatchet man for McCarthy. And over again, we see Roy Cohn sitting at his right hand. He becomes the one that pushes McCarthy certain ways. Now, Margaret Chase Smith is important in this story, too. Margaret Chase Smith is in the U.S. Senate. She's a Republican from Maine. She was elected to the U.S. Congress in 1942, I believe. Her husband was in the Congress. He passed away. She took his seat, but then was reelected several times in the U.S. House. Then ran for Senate, became a U.S. Senator. She's the only female in the Senate at this time. In 1950, she gives a speech in the U.S. Senate called the Declaration of Conscience, in which she criticizes her fellow partisan, Joe McCarthy, and what he's doing. So she stands up and takes a stand. And I just want to read a portion of what she had to say. She was very critical of the Democrats who were in power, Harry Truman and the Democrats who were in power in Congress. So she first blasted them for a series of things. But then she said, surely these are sufficient reasons, sufficient actions by the Democratic Party to make it clear to the American people that it is time for a change and that a Republican victory is necessary to the security of this country. Surely it is clear that this nation will continue to suffer as long as it's governed by the present ineffective Democratic administration. Yet, to displace it with a Republican regime embracing a philosophy that lacks political integrity or intellectual honesty would prove equally disastrous to this nation. The nation sorely needs a Republican victory, but I don't want to see the Republican Party ride to political victory on the four horsemen of calumny. I'm not sure how to pronounce that. By which I mean fear, ignorance, bigotry, and smear. She gives this speech on the floor of the U.S. Senate, the only female in the chamber, right? So there are people, many thousands, who have stood up at different times in our history as a nation. There are people in Great Britain right now who are making decisions. So the least we can do is contemplate our choices. So Margaret Chase Smith is a critic of McCarthy, and she's in the same party. She risks her political career. Doesn't damage her long term, but she risks it. Roy Cohn becomes the hatchet man, the kind of the bomb thrower for McCarthy. In 1954, it all falls apart for McCarthy. He's ridden the tsunami up, and eventually he starts to go after generals in the military, and now there is a general in the military, or former general, who's the president of the United States, Dwight Eisenhower at this point. And so McCarthy goes after these people in the U.S. Army, and there's this set of U.S. Army hearings, and in the middle of that is the famous kind of moment in which he attacks the young aide of one of these military members, these generals. He attacks them, and Joseph Welch, the lawyer for the Army, says, have you no decency? Have you no decency, Senator? All right. After this, I want to show you a video clip. Edward R. Murrow runs a special. Edward R. Murrow was the preeminent journalist of the time. He did a lot of great things. He made the mistake of going to Washington State University instead of University of Washington. So now they have the Edward R. Murrow School of Communications, all right? All right? But he's one of my American heroes. Not a perfect, no one's ever perfect. But he laid it out in a way that we would not see from a leading national journalist until Cronkite goes to Vietnam.
Earlier, the senator asked, upon what meat does this our Caesar feed?
So this is the last of like what has been a 30-minute special. This is the last, it's the concluding comments by Murrow.
Had he looked three lines earlier in Shakespeare's Caesar, he would have found this line, which is not altogether inappropriate. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves. No one familiar with the history of his country can deny that congressional committees are useful. It is necessary to investigate before legislating. But the line between investigating and persecuting is a very fine one, and the junior senator from Wisconsin has stepped over it repeatedly. His primary achievement has been in confusing the public mind as between the internal and the external threats of communism. We must not confuse dissent with disloyalty. We must remember always that accusation is not proof, and that conviction depends upon evidence and due process of law. We will not walk in fear one of another. We will not be driven by fear into an age of unreason if we dig deep in our history and our doctrine, and remember that we are not descended from fearful men. Not from men who feared to write, to speak, to associate, and to defend causes that were for the moment unpopular. This is no time for men who oppose Senator McCarthy's methods to keep silent, or for those who approve. We can deny our heritage and our history, but we cannot escape responsibility for the result. There is no way for a citizen of a republic to abdicate his responsibilities. As a nation, we have come into our full inheritance at a tender age. We proclaim ourselves, as indeed we are, the defenders of freedom wherever it continues to exist in the world. But we cannot defend freedom abroad by deserting it at home. The actions of the junior senator from Wisconsin have caused alarm and dismay amongst our allies abroad and given considerable comfort to our enemies. And whose fault is that? Not really his. He didn't create this situation of fear. He merely exploited it, and rather successfully. Cassius was right. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves. Good night, and good luck.
So he goes too far, McCarthy does, but not before destroying many people's lives. He eventually is stopped because of the kind of courage of a Margaret Chase Smith, or because of the kind of quality of journalism of a Edward R. Murrow. So that's another way to stop a demagogue, is to put, you know, your career and your integrity on the line. In 1957, he's an alcoholic. Murrow is. His life deteriorates, and in 1957, 3 years later, he dies. So, who'd I say? No, I'm my bad. Yeah. So let me rewind that and say, Edward R. Murrow goes on to a distinguished rest of his career. Okay. Gives an incredible speech in 1958 about the damage of broadcast television in American life. Really, it's more than a box he talks about. It's not just a box of wires. It's much more than that. So Murrow goes on to many things. McCarthy is an alcoholic in trouble, and his life is damaged significantly by all this, and he dies in 1957. So So I'm gonna wrap up here then for tonight. And I've talked about two demagogues who paved the who Trump will essentially channel in terms of how he does work. And I will, at the in about two-thirds of the way through the lecture next time when I get to Trump, I'll talk about kind of pieces from each of these people that he picks up, that Trump picks up. But I just want to kind of point out, I want to make a specific point that Long's argument was an economic argument. He was an ideologue. Really, it's not a fair comparison by any means, but it's the Bernie Sanders argument. It really is. I think if you read Huey Long's speeches, he sounds a lot like Bernie Sanders. They sound very similar. Now, he's doing a lot of other things that Sanders is not doing, but the ideas are similar. For Long, though, it wasn't enough for the ideas. He needed all that power, too. All that power. For McCarthy, he targets foreign policy and sees this as the vulnerable spot in the American psyche, the fear around Cold War issues. And he targets supposed communists and subversive sexual identity folks in our society. He builds this constructed imagery around the dangers that they present and jams them together and says that they're endangering America. So the demagogues are nothing if not creative in terms of their targets. They find the weak links. In fact, it's almost animalistic in it in that they smell the weak spots and then they go for it. Right? And this is where the feeding off of the crowds and the realities of needing to be in the presence of people constantly who praise you and give you incredible feedback, because you just can't stand weakness. The weakness must be exploited and used to your advantage. Next time, I'm going to pick up and talk about three more, and then we're going to get to Trump. And these are folks that are going to accentuate issues of culture, things that are going to be domestic American, and they're going to be elements of what makes this country kind of the modern America that we think of. So I'll see you next week, okay? Yeah. See, that's how I finish. See you next week, man. That's where you step.